Hey, folks, and welcome again to the Newburyport Documentary Film Festival. I'm Program Director James Sullivan, we are, believe it or not, entering our 18th year as of 2022. What we'd like to do today, however, is to take a quick look back at our last festival in September, our 17th annual, when we introduced for the first time a brand new award for emerging filmmakers, student filmmakers, called the Young Emerging Student Filmmaker Award, or the YES Awards. And we think the program went incredibly well. We had five submissions that were accepted and shown live at the festival in September. And I think four of the five filmmakers were there with us on hand to talk about their films. We loved all of them, but could only award one winner. We have that winner here with us today. Dominick Torres is a recent graduate of Wheaton College, and his film is called Aguante. And what I'd like to do now is just to call up the trailer so we can take a look at it, and then I will introduce Dominick.
De acuerdo a la Organización de las Naciones Unidas, Puerto Rico tiene una de las tasas más altas de feminicidio en América Latina. Este año, en el 2019, han muerto entre 7 a 8 mujeres a manos de su expareja o la pareja actual. Pero en un año completo, en Puerto Rico mueren entre 50 a 60 mujeres. Y eso es muchísimo.
El huracán María pasó en el año 2017, en septiembre de 2017. Definitivamente devastó la isla de Puerto Rico y causó que viéramos una realidad social que muchas personas quizás no querían ver.
Hurricane Maria not only devastated the Puerto Rican economy, but the hurricane led to a spike in the island's gender-based violence and femicide rates. The passing of the hurricane showed that women continue to be vulnerable to abuse despite strong laws to protect them.
La violencia psicológica, lo que pasa es que muchas veces los jueces piensan que tú necesitas un perito psicológico, un psicólogo, para probar el daño. Pero la ley no requiere que se pruebe que se ha sufrido daño, sino que lo hace con la intención de causar daño.
We need to understand that our society is very violent at this moment in Puerto Rico because inequality, because gender differences, because our values also, the way that we were raised as macho sometimes, and even the woman, the way that they were raised makes it more difficult.
So Dominick Torres is here with us today from his home in the Bronx in New York City. Hi, Dominick.
Hey, how you doing, James?
Thanks for being with us again. Dominick was one of the students who was able to make it to Newburyport to discuss his film during our festival in September. And then he took home the grand prize, which is $500, thanks to our sponsors. So we were thrilled to make that award to you, and congratulations.
Thank you. I really appreciated being awarded.
Tell us about the film. You told a good story about how you came to make this film. It's pretty powerful, obviously, about, gender violence in Puerto Rico. And you kind of came about the project, sideways, right? Like you were in Puerto Rico for another reason, right? And this story idea came to you. Do I remember it correctly?
Yeah. So when I was in Puerto Rico, it was actually a faculty-led trip from Wheaton College where they had a filmmaker in resident. And you were, brought on the trip to sort of figure out a story. And originally I had just planned to cover the effects of Hurricane Maria. And I was really sort of set on, making that film and highlighting, the relationship with the U.S. and how, disaster capitalism is rampant in the Caribbean was my original focus, like sort of exclusively. And when talking to a lot of you know, experts, activists in Puerto Rico, they were really gearing me towards talking about how like Hurricane Maria was almost the sort of unveiling and reveal for the world to see the corruption that was happening in Puerto Rico. And so they said there was these monsters that have existed since the creation of what is known to be modern Puerto Rico after colonialization, which is, you know, economic violence, gender-based violence, you know, labor violence. So like all these other sort of, things that they thought were way more important to be discussing, because it's sort of like the fabric and the, you know, poor infrastructure that the island is built upon. And so when learning a lot about gender-based violence, I almost like couldn't turn my eye. I had to cover that story. And that's how I came about. So I was already there researching other stuff, and then started meeting with a lot of gender-based violence, you know, activists, and communities working to combat it, and just, you know, kind of immediately shifted my gears to cover that story instead. So mm-hmm. It's kind of like a three, you know, real big turnaround moment to shift my research just while.
So you had good journalistic training, because I tell my journalism students all the time, you go out thinking you know what your story is, but if the circumstances tell you otherwise, don't be afraid to say that the story has shifted, right? Like, so this happens a lot. You know, you start talking to people and, you know, you tell your editor, well, the story is different than we thought it was when we went out to report it. Yeah. And sometimes editors push back because they're like, well, that's not the story we expected to get. But you literally just found a total, like, listen to people and found a totally different story than you thought you were going to go and make. So bravo to some journalism professor along the way, or maybe just your own instincts. But, you know, right. Somebody did the right thing. Maybe it was just you without any help. But great job. So tell me a little more. And again, I think we talked about this when you were here. Tell me a little more about the idea of you, a man, making a film about, you know, violence against women. Did you have to earn the trust of some of these experts, these women, professors and otherwise, activists who you spoke with as a guy, to get them to say, you know, I hear where you're coming from, and I'm going to do right by your story?
Yeah, I think, you know, one of the most important things in terms of the interpersonal ability to gain the trust of all the researchers and experts in the film is that, they too had hesitancy about me being a male, you know, covering the story about gender-based violence. But I really, you know, the film is honestly just, you know, my curation and sort of connections I was able to find through all of their sort of rhetoric. So I wasn't trying to say, you know, I never talked to them as if like I'm the expert, right? I was always the student in the room. I just happened to have a camera while learning, right? And so like them understanding that I was too learning and using this tool and this medium of filmmaking as being a better person, right? So like this was a self sort of investment where I had to, you know, lean into learning and really push myself to be a better, you know, citizen of the world. And I think a lot of people responded well to that, because what comes with that is just a lot of listening, right? I'm not coming to the room saying, hey, I know these things. Mm-hmm. What do you think about them? It's really responding to what you've heard. So a lot of times, you know, we'd go to like a guest lecture by them. You know, I take all these notes and I just want them to like recap things they said, or like push and give me more details and teach me the nuances of what was happening. And so that was on the interpersonal level. But for me to commit to the project from the beginning, the biggest thought I had was, you know, when we talk about race relations, right, like racism is like really a white people problem, right? Like it's a structure created, you know, by them. And so they have to do the work to solve it. And I said, well, you know, like what if we looked at macho culture, the patriarchy, mm-hmm. in the same way, right? It's a violent, you know, structure created by men. And so like we have to be at the forefront learning in ways to dismantle and become citizens of the world. Mm-hmm. I really, you know, moved in that intentionality to say that, you know, I am doing the work that's uncomfortable. I'm putting that mirror in front of mm-hmm. myself, right? Like this film is a direct challenge to my existence. Mm-hmm. And so to do that, I thought was a very, you know, unique way to try and challenge myself to be better for the world and sort of, you know, give my understanding, right? I don't, you know, move the film in a way that's saying this is sort of the end all be all and this is all the, you know, things we need to know. This is just my synthesis of what I was able to get access to. And so this is my understanding and wrestling with all these concepts.
Yeah, that's a great analogy with the white people racism thing. Absolutely. Putting the mirror on yourself. You know, not to get too personal, you know, but I'm curious about your own perspective. Like, you know, you're a young man. You know, were there things about sort of macho culture that you had previously maybe not given enough thought to or grown up surrounded by or recognized on your way towards the age you are now that you now feel much more strongly about being proactive on behalf of women? Not to say that you've experienced any, you know, again, not to get too personal, not to say that you've experienced anything in particular, but just the general idea of, you know, dudes.
Yeah.
Right. And, you know, and the fact that probably every male has something to learn, you know, continually throughout their lives about how better to treat women.
Yeah, I think, you know, one of the things that the film, so like my film is really geared towards the sort of governmental structures, right? The societal structures we have in place and the infrastructure that allow for violence to exist at the interpersonal level. Mm-hmm. But I think one of the things that made me very compelled to join this project was, you know, my grandmother was like a big influence in my life, and she's a feminist or was a feminist and spent a lot of her years, you know, working to create gender equality, you know, create equity for women. And so actually like the ability to like learn from all of these women, you know, a lot of people have talked to me like that would have been a challenge for them. But like for me, that's actually a very comfortable space to be in, is to be learning from women and sort of like understanding the world through those lenses, right? That's because that's how I learned growing up. Was like, yeah, you know, primarily the educator in my life was my grandmother. I spent a lot of time, you know, and she loved academics, so she's always supporting me through my academics and my art. And so to me, it was actually like a really normal space to be in. But you start, you know, when I started to learn about it in a more structured way, rather than just like a, you know, this kind of happens between partners or between, you know, interpersonally, I started realizing how massive these structures were, right? So like you kind of have a general sense, right? You know, something's wrong, but to sort of like learn the language and the magnitude behind it, that was sort of like invaluable. You know, I think it really put an extra battery in the back that already existed to sort of further this work and push it and create this project to challenge people, right? I really talk about it as a conversation starter when I show it at places, because I've had, you know, reactions of people saying it's made them uncomfortable, you know, and it's hard to think about, and, you know, and so that was like one of the things that it really did for me, was sort of, like I said, teach me more about that structural framework that allows for the culture to exist, rather than just looking at the culture as an isolated experience. There's a bigger structure designed around it.
I'm guessing your grandma was from New York, but is she, where was she? Did she move here from elsewhere, or is she Puerto Rican in descent?
Her family was from Puerto Rico, but she was born and raised in New York, but felt a very strong connection to, you know, her roots in Puerto Rico. So
is she not with us anymore, or?
No.
She didn't get to see this made.
No. She had heard of the beginning of the project, but never got to see the final film.
But she knew you were making it.
Yeah.
She knew when you got started, right?
Yeah. She was one of the first people to give me like books to start my research.
Oh, wow. Amazing. So
you read these things, these women, or give really good framework for that concept. And then, you know, kind of, you just look through what those people read and you're down a rabbit hole of, you know, literature. But she's definitely the first people to put books in my lap about this topic.
Right. Great. The opening scene, which is not reflected in your trailer, but it's really powerful. It's a huge crowd of women singing, right? An activist song against violence against women, right? And you want to describe the song and tell me how you got that shot?
Yeah, so that's the Chilean femicide song. I had actually seen the song you know, some years before, because there was a lot of, there's a lot of, you know, activism and using that song as a way to promote the activism happening, you know, in Latin and Central America. And during the you know, removal of the governor, Ricky Rosselló, there was a lot of feminist activists who were standing at the forefront, you know, using the song, the Chilean femicide song, as a way to gain, you know, like to express what's been happening here, you know, in Puerto Rico. And so, you know, the reason, you know, for using the song was actually I had this filmmaker I'd found had got that shot. And so I asked them, I said, hey, you know, I really want to use this as the opener for my film. I think this song encapsulates what I'm trying to do with the entire film. It sort of like sets the whole thing up, you know. And he's like, of course, you know, we worked it out and we were able to get the shot in the film. And so I think, you know, the reason I chose to go with that strong of an opening and like really drag it out was to, one, communicate like this sort of magnitude of what's happening, right? Like, if you see this many women who have something to say, like clearly something's been going on for a very long time, right? This is not, again, some sort of isolated experience. This is like institutionally designed to allow this violence to exist. And I thought that that sort of moment really encapsulated almost everything of like what the film was. You know, mm-hmm. I think if you just listen to that song, read the lyrics, you know, you can really get a sense of like what's happening. And sort of, like I said, that institutional governmental support to allow violence to exist. Mm-hmm. I felt that it really, really compelled and set up the whole project and really sort of gave this dramatization moment for people to really lean into this story.
Right. Totally agree. can you tell us a little bit? So we were thrilled with the way the first Yes Award went. I think I misspoke earlier. We're still stumbling over it's the Young Emerging Filmmakers Showcase. And I'm not sure if I said it right or not earlier, but it's the YES Yes Award. And, you know, we didn't necessarily know what to expect. It was the first year that we did it, the first year that we reached out to film schools and, you know, film programs at various colleges to look for submissions. And I'm sure you didn't know what to expect, right? I mean, how did you find out about submitting from a professor, I would assume, or somebody at the school? You know, what can you tell me about your experience of coming up to Newburyport and showing the film and talking to the audience and then finding out that you won?
Yeah, so interesting enough, I had actually applied to Newburyport outside of the Yes category.
Oh, wow.
But forgetting that through my institution, Wheaton College, Massachusetts, that I had already applied. So, you know, my professor got a message, you know, via email saying like, hey, we're looking for submissions. And he, you know, he sent it to me immediately. He's like, hey, man, I think this is you. This has Aguante written all over it. You know, you should really apply. I think you stand a good chance. You know, this kind of seems like your film fits the sort of mission of the Newburyport Film Festival. And, I really trust his guidance. And so I went and applied. But I had also, through Film Freeway, applied through, you know, anyway to the Newburyport. So actually, I got a message and I was like, they were like, hey, which one do you want to go to? And I was like, I'll do the Yes Award. And, you know, applying to it and then knowing that I was a selection was just, I mean, like, that was enough for me. You know, I'd had some issues, you know, sort of trying to get this film into festivals, I think, because from a subject matter standpoint, it's kind of like, it's a real dense sort of thematic like project, right? It's not sort of your happy go lucky documentary that's going to allow for some escapism. It's really challenging. And it talks a lot about institutional structures and things like that. And so I was kind of applying to like documentary festivals that were really in the mode of like entertaining, you know, and I don't think this is a film that's trying to really do entertaining, right? I think it's, like I said, it's sort of like facilitation piece to really challenge your, you know, knowledge and existence as a male. And mm-hmm. So, you know, I started to gear more towards festivals that were looking for submissions like that. And that's how I discovered Newburyport. And quite honestly, like you can ask all my friends, like, you know, after we showed everything, I was calling people. I'm like, no way, you know, there's no way, you know, like, you know, because I'm just like excited to be there. And it's just like, you know, there's other films there that are, you know, like exceptionally well. And so you kind of just like, you don't, I didn't expect to win, right? I was just like excited to go to the feature of the night and watch that film. And kind of just like, for me, I was like really, you know, thinking about networking, wanting to talk to people, you know, cause I had like, you know, I already had my next doc like thought out, and I was kind of like just seeing what people would think, you know? And then, so I'm sitting there, and then, you know, you like announced that I'm the winner. And like for a brief moment, I kind of just like looked around like, oh, where's the person who's going to win? And like, everybody's looking at me. And I was like, oh, wait, that's me. That's my name. You know? And I was kind of like, you know, it was like super just like ecstatic and excited to be up there. I was like super nervous when I had to talk. Because you're just like so excited, like, you know, not nervous in a scared way, just like so overwhelmed with joy. You kind of like, you know, like losing your breath.
I didn't seem nervous.
Yeah. But like, it's like, you know, you're just so excited. And, you know, I had to like, okay, I was like, okay, guy, put the poker face on. Like, let's do this, right? Like, there's something you need to say. This film means a lot to me.
Yeah.
I want people to understand, like, this is very serious to me. You know, this topic isn't, you know, something like, I don't make my work to be, you know, extractive from communities, right? Like, I want to be very proactive in the communities I'm working with, right? Like, mm-hmm. That's my mission as a filmmaker is, you know, I tell people, I'm like, I don't give people a voice. I'm only a soundboard to the voice that is already there, right? Like, right. There's communities that are being neglected, and people that are speaking, they just need sometimes a little megaphone to help them reach a wider audience. And that's all I want to do is be that megaphone for people and help push what they are asking for. You know, and that's kind of, I think, what allowed, like I said at the beginning, all these activists to like welcome me to their work, is that I just made it clear, like, I'm not trying to take your voice, mm-hmm. right? I'm just trying to help move your voice, right? Like, I'm trying to mobilize it into a media-based outlet, right? Like, I'm using my craft to move your mission. And so mm-hmm. we're working together to build this story. You know, I'm not the, you know, driver of this train. I'm just helping conduct it. And I think that, you know, that was like, when I got up there, I kind of calmed myself down, and that I reminded myself that that's what I'm here to do.
Yeah.
And then, you know, was like super honored to win and gave the speech.
That's very well said. You are now, you know, have graduated and are embarking on your work towards, you know, becoming a full-time filmmaker, right? So are you, you know, what do you care to tell us about what you got going right now for next project, or plural, maybe multiple project, hopefully?
Yeah, no, I'm currently working on a few different projects, but the main one that I'm centering and hunkering down, I'm like working with other productions as like a cinematographer and doing some producing work, helping story development. But the story that I've really been focusing on is I want to highlight, I want to really make a New York story. You know, I've always wanted to make one. You know, I'm born and raised in New York. I still live here. And growing up as a kid, my grandfather always told me about sort of pigeons, you know, culture in New York, where, you know, a lot of guys would have coops on their roofs and race their pigeons and fly them and raise them. And, you know, I grew up watching Mike Tyson talk a lot about this. And so I want to embark on, you know, I'm hoping to make a short, which will then gain some traction and show people that I can do a feature. But right now I want to do a short on a man named Vinny Outerbridge. He's one of the most like renowned, most decorated pigeon, you know, raisers. They're called fanciers. He raises pigeons and kind of breeds them to be like excellent. And I'm hoping to use his story to help scaffold my first feature doc, which will be sort of really understanding the cultural aspect of what this pigeon culture did in the 70s. And, you know, how all these like guys like Mike Tyson are still to this day raising pigeons, right? Like, something had to happen. Something was that, you know, meaningful to them about raising these pigeons and flying them and the whole culture behind it that, you know, still to this day, they're doing it. And, you know, the film is also going to highlight, you know, like the drug epidemic of the 70s and of modern day gentrification, and how gentrification is actually, you know, sapping out the what was originally known to be New York, you know, like that sort of iconic New York is leaving. And so I want to highlight gentrification and how, you know, people don't want to deal with the pigeons anymore. And there's a lot, you know, to sort of scaffold. And from, so I want to highlight it sort of like the same way I did in Aguante, this cultural sense, not just like the individual, but I want to use Vinny's story as a way to make a short and, you know, chaperone it around and maybe get some people to, you know, be interested in helping me create this feature.
Right.
To talk about New York.
Sounds great. I'm a New Englander, but I was born in Queens. So I look forward to your I love New York, and I look forward to your New York stories. And we look forward to seeing you hopefully back here again in Newburyport sometime soon. So best of luck and congratulations again on being the first. You'll always be the first winner of the Yes Award at the Newburyport Documentary Film Festival. So thanks for taking the time to talk to us, Dominick, and best of luck.
Yeah, thank you again, James. And thank you to everybody at the Newburyport Film Festival. I felt so welcomed, and I would definitely love to be back.
Great. We'll take a moment to thank our sponsors. And please take a moment for yourselves and check out our YouTube channel. We've got some great other filmmaker interviews there, and we will continue adding them. So look forward to seeing you again sometime soon. Happy holidays, everybody. And thanks again to our sponsors, and thanks again to Dominick.